Let's start. This is what we had done in the last several minutes of the previous lecture. We started the Newton's laws. We have these three laws which we use to describe any kind of motion that you can see around you. The first law, which basically describes the what we mean by an inertial reference frame. The laws of Newton are valid only in inertial reference frames. They are not valid in non-inertial reference frames. And it says that if there are no external influences on an object in an inertial reference frame, then its acceleration is zero. Yes, question? Why? Is it too... Is it better now? No. Like this? Okay. Okay, so this is the definition of the inertial reference frame. In an inertial reference frame, if there are no external forces acting on an object, then its velocity should be constant. If it is at rest, it should stay at rest. It is moving, it should keep on moving at constant velocity. If an object doesn't obey this law in a given reference frame, it just means that it is not an inertial reference frame. Then we had discussed the second law and the third law. The second law is the famous F equal to ma, the acceleration of an object. A force causes the object to accelerate, and the acceleration is just force over the mass. And the third law is the action-reaction pair. So whenever you are acting a force on some other object, that object is acting a force on you. For example, this laptop over here, we see that it is at rest. It is not accelerating. So it means that it has to have a net zero force acting on it. One of the forces is its weight. So its weight is pulling it downward. But then there's also the table acting on my force, on my laptop, which is pushing it upward. These two forces balance each other. And we can use the second and the third laws to define the mass. We have been talking about the mass. You are probably quite intuitively very familiar what mass is. But when it comes to defining what the mass is, we really don't have a definition, a real answer for what mass of an object is. We can measure it. Newton's second and third law allows us to measure the mass of any object relative to some standard unit. And we just use, this is one of the systems. We have two masses attached by a spring. The third law guarantees that they both feel the same force. So if they both feel the same force, Newton's second law tells us that their acceleration is proportional to their masses. And by measuring the acceleration, we can just determine the mass of the unknown mass relative to our standard mass. And once we know the mass of an object, we look at an object, we measure its acceleration, then we can say that, okay, there is this force acting on it. So in this sense, the second law is also the definition of force. Force is something that causes an object to accelerate by that given amount. So if you measure that the acceleration of an object is 2 meters per second squared, its mass is, let's say, 4 kilograms, in terms of the standard unit that we call the kilogram. In that case, we say that the force acting on the object is 8 kilograms meters per second squared, which we just say that 8 newtons. Now, this is what we had done until. Okay, this is a point to take into account. The acceleration itself is not the force. Acceleration is not responsible for the force. Acceleration is not creating the force. It is the force that creates the acceleration. Okay, so if you see an acceleration, then you should ask yourself that what is the force acting on the object that creates this given acceleration? Okay? Well, we will be studying rotational motion, but this gets important in rotational motion. For example, just imagine that you are moving in a car and you are just taking a turn to the left. Well, we all had the had this experience. When the car rotates to the left, we feel a force to the right. Right? Yes? Yes. So you are going in a car, you are staying in a car, the car makes a left turn, a fast left turn, then you will be pushed to the right. Okay? So in an inertial reference frame, what is happening is that your velocity vector was in this direction, but then your velocity vector changed its direction, so you are accelerating. You have accelerated towards the left. So the force acting on you, if you are turning left, is towards the left. It is not towards the right. There is no force acting on you which points towards the right. The force is towards the left, because your acceleration is towards the left. Questions? Goes straight. Sure. Okay, so if there is this rope, you are holding it, so there is a force along this rope which acts a force, which causes a force on your ball, and the direction of this force is towards your hand. So the ball, if it's going like this, it feels a force in this direction, so it rotates its velocity vector. So it's accelerating in this direction, so that's why it rotates. When you cut the rope, the only force left is the gravity. But it doesn't cause the horizontal motion to curve or change. So after you cut the rope, the horizontal motion is motion with constant velocity. So it doesn't change its magnitude, it doesn't change its direction. So this is what we mean by weight. In this semester, in this year, let's say, everything we will be studying will be basically related with two forces only. The weight, that's the gravitational force, and anything else you experience in your everyday life will be electromagnetic force, including the when you sit on your chairs, well, you are not moving, your acceleration is zero, but you know that you have your weight pushing you down. So there should be some other force, just like in the case of the laptop, pushing you up. It is your chair which is pushing you up. That force, the origin of that force, is basically electromagnetic. So you have the atoms making your, let's say, if I clap my hands just do not go through each other, although I am applying a force. So what's happening is the atoms in one of my hands and the atoms in the other hand, they just get so close that the electrons start to repel each other. So once they start to repel each other, the closer they are, the stronger there will be the repulsion. So once this repulsion balances the external force that I'm applying, my hands will stop moving because the net force will be zero. So that's why one of my hand cannot go through the other one of my hand. Well, we are saying that, okay, one hand is pushing the other one, but the push is caused by electromagnetic interaction. Any other force except than the weight, the gravitational force that we will study, is electromagnetic in origin, including friction. Friction is also caused indirectly by electromagnetic interactions. Now, when we were studying the motion with constant acceleration, we said that close to the surface of the Earth, at least, all objects have the same acceleration. But then Newton's second law tells us that, well, assuming the surface of the Earth is inertial, it is almost inertial, then there should be a force acting on my object, which causes this acceleration. Since every object has the same acceleration, g, in this equation I just denoted by the vector g, the gravitational acceleration vector, so any mass that has a mass m should feel a force, the so-called weight of the object, is equal to mass times this gravitational acceleration. This is due to the Newton's second law. It has to be there. How do you measure weight? Well, just using a scale. If you have a scale at home in your dormitories, you can just climb on it and you read how many kilograms you are. Well, the scale is in fact a balance. It has springs inside. So you step on the scale and it tells you that you are such and such kilograms. Well, it is telling you a lie, that is one thing. It is not measuring your mass. It is measuring your weight. But since the gravitational acceleration on the surface is more or less constant everywhere on the surface of the Earth, then it will tell you from your weight it can deduce your mass approximately. Of course, if you want to weigh less, you can just go to the top of the Mount Everest and there you will weigh less, although your mass will be the same. So let's look at this example. I have the scale on top of it. That rectangle is you standing on the scale. You can imagine the forces acting on you. You have your weight, but you are standing on the scale. You are not accelerating along your weight, along the direction of your weight. So that should be your scale acts, creates a force on you, which is normal to the surface. That's why it is called the normal force. So these are the only two forces that act on you. It is your weight, the gravity is pulling you, and the normal force created by the scale is pushing you up. Well, most of the time, when we are studying these mechanical problems, what we do is, rather than looking at the problem as a whole, for each mass in question, we draw what's called a free body diagram. That is our mass. Well, we will also be studying examples where you have more than a single mass. You have your masses. And at each mass, there are several forces acting on the mass. So in this special case, we have our mass, and there are just two forces acting on my mass. It is my weight, pointing downward, and the normal force, pointing upward. At this point, before you ask, at this point, since we are assuming that everything is almost point-like, so although I'm just drawing a large mass, if we ignore the motion, rotation, everything can be treated as point-like, and so it doesn't really matter where you show the forces acting on, whether it's acting on the bottom or on the top, it doesn't really make any difference. So this is my free body diagram for this problem. I have my mass and the two forces. Then I can calculate the net force acting on each mass. Well, in this case, since I have two forces, I just sum them up, the normal force plus the weight. But since the object is not accelerating at all, the net force has to be zero. So F net is zero. It just tells me that the normal force acting on me, created by the scale, is just opposite to my weight. So that the net force just cancels, and I don't accelerate neither upwards or downwards. Now the next question, what does the scale measure? Well, the scale basically measures the force that I act on on it. It doesn't measure the force that it acts on me, but the force that I act on it. Well, the distinction doesn't really make too much importance because I know that the magnitudes of these two forces are equal from the Newton's third law. The force acting on the scale due to me is just minus this normal force because they are just action-reaction pairs. And the magnitude is the magnitude of my weight, which is nothing but mg. This is probably the longest way to solve this problem. But it does demonstrate the principles that can be used in any more complicated problem also. Now we will just complicate it slightly a bit more. We are in the elevator. Well, I'm sure you have taken the elevator, at least in the physics department, to go to the secretary, so you should know the feeling. You go to the ground floor, you get into the elevator, and you press the fourth floor, and when the elevator stops to go up, you just feel a force that pushes you down. Similarly, when you reach the fourth floor, as it stops, you just feel like there is a force pushing you up. So this pushing that, this feeling will also reflect on the scale. If we put a scale in the elevator, and then measure our weight in this elevator as the elevator is accelerating, it can be going up or down. Right, if I'm in the ground floor going up, it is accelerating in the upward direction, and when it reaches the fourth floor, it is accelerating in the downward direction. Now, let's see, what are my forces here in the game? I have the normal force. That is the force the scale will be acting on me. I'm standing on the scale. I'm acting a force on the scale. So the scale acts a force on me. But that is my z direction pointing upwards. That is how I chose it. It's just free. So the normal force is just the component along the z direction and z hat. N is my unknown. I don't know what this normal force is. It is one of the things that I would like to calculate. I have my weight, which is pointing downward, minus mgz. I have the I know the acceleration of the elevator. Let's say I measured it somehow. And it is ae along the z hat direction. But ae can be both positive and negative. That is what will determine whether my acceleration is pointing upward or pointing downward. In the figure over here, if you look at that acceleration vector over there, it just assumes that AE is negative. If AE is negative, it will be pointing downward. If the component was positive, it will be going upward. So we know, well, in the elevator, probably none of you fell down as the elevator started to move up, and probably none of you started to fly as the elevator was stopping at the fourth floor. That basically means that your velocity at each time is the same thing as the velocity of the elevator. You should have the same velocities. But if you and the elevator have the same velocity, it means that at all times, it just means that you have the same acceleration. So that A over there is your acceleration. Now, the difference of this case from the previous case is, since the elevator is accelerating, you are inside the elevator. So you are also accelerating with the elevator, so there is a net acceleration. That means there is a net force on you, a non-zero net force. Well, the net force acting on you is created by your weight and the normal force. Those are the only forces that are acting on you. If you just sum them up, N is in the positive z direction, your weight is in the negative z direction, so the net force acting on you is N minus mg along the z hat direction. It can be positive, negative, I don't know. It's not even important at this point. Well, this should be the mass, your mass, times your acceleration. Your acceleration is nothing but the same thing as the acceleration of the elevator, so the total force has to be m times ae along the z-hat direction. Well, I have two equal vectors, so their components have to be equal. And it just tells me that the normal force acting on you by the scale is your mass times g plus the acceleration of the elevator. In the reference frame of the elevator, it is just as if that the gravity has been, acceleration of gravity has been modified. You just feel like the gravitational acceleration is not g, but g plus the acceleration of the elevator. That's the only difference. Well, the force acting on the scale, well, n is the force acting on you created by the scale. Minus n is the force acting on the scale by you. That is what the scale will measure. But it has the same magnitude as n, so the scale will show your weight as m times g plus the acceleration of the elevator. Well, if you are going upward, that means your acceleration is, initially at least, you are in the ground floor, you just step in the elevator, you press the button, and you wait, then the elevator starts to move. You have an upward acceleration. If you have an upward acceleration, AE is positive, So this just tells me that g is just a number, a fixed number, 9.8 meters per second squared approximately. It is a positive number. Well, if you add two positive numbers, you get a larger number. So m times g plus ae is your new acceleration, new weight, which is larger than mg. This is when you are going up. So that's why you feel as if you are pushed down. You weigh more in that reference frame. When you reach the fourth floor, the elevator starts to stop. So your acceleration is pointing downward. It just means that this number AE is negative. If AE is negative, this result tells me that your weight measured by the scale is less than your actual weight. So that's why you feel like there is a force pushing you up when you reach the fourth floor. That was a question over there. No?
Can we accept it as an inertial force?
Okay, so just first warning, always, always, always use inertial reference frames. Because in those reference frames, we have the Newton's laws. If you go to non-inertial reference frames, I mean, you can study nature in any reference frame that you like. It doesn't have to be inertial. But inertial reference frames will make your life much, much more easier. If you prefer to use a non-inertial reference frame, then you can study the same problem with the only modification that in this new non-inertial reference frame, there is an additional gravitational acceleration given by AE, the acceleration of the elevator. In fact, this is what such arguments led Einstein to drive his general theory of relativity. So Einstein first started with his special theory of relativity. Well, we had already seen relativity, in a sense. It's not the Einstein theory of relativity, but we have studied relative motion. We had seen that velocity is always defined, should always be defined relative to a reference frame. So, hold on a bit. So velocity is always defined relative to a reference frame. If you go to another reference frame, the velocity will be different. But we know that the laws of nature should be independent of the reference frames. So the laws of nature cannot really depend on the velocity of an object. But you can interpret this in another way. If the laws of nature is independent of the reference frame, then if you are in a closed box, and you make some experiments in your closed box, there is no possibility of telling whether you are moving or not, because you are not allowed to compare yourself with another reference frame. And in that case, you cannot measure your velocity relative to something else. But if you look at this expression, suppose you are v and v prime are the velocities of my object in two different inertial reference frames. In that case, v has to be a constant vector, this large v. The two reference frames should be moving at constant velocity relative to each other. But as in the case of our elevator, V, capital V is changing. The relative velocity of my reference frame is changing. So if the acceleration in one reference, well, just take the time derivative of this V equal to V prime plus capital V. So in the non-inertial reference frame, you will have some acceleration even if you don't have in the other reference frame. So it just acts as if all the objects are accelerating at additional gravitational acceleration. So from this, and before people said that, okay, I cannot tell if a reference frame is moving at constant velocity or not. So that was widely accepted. But people still thought that I can always tell whether a reference frame is accelerating or not. If I'm in a closed box, I can always tell whether that box is accelerating or not. What I can do, we will see an example. I can just suspend the pendulum. If your reference frame is accelerating, in that case, your pendulum will be shifted. But then Einstein rejected this idea also. He claims that in a closed box, you can never tell whether your reference frame is accelerating or not. He made this claim on the assumption that, on the observation that, just an accelerating reference frame is almost identical to a gravitating reference frame, a constant reference frame in a gravitational force. So if you are in a closed box, he said, you cannot tell the difference whether your box is accelerating or whether there is a planet moving close to your box. So he claimed that you cannot distinguish the two. And from these arguments, he reached his general theory of relativity. But to sum up, if these arguments just getting you more confused, forget about them, we will be always, always, always working in inertial reference frames, okay? And in inertial reference frames, Newton's laws hold. If something is accelerating, there has to be an external force acting on it. I am, with respect to Earth. If I'm not stating my reference frame, I'm always talking with respect to Earth.
Our box is the Earth.
Yes. Well, the last week I was not here on Tuesday, so you had this integral recitation hour. I was in a conference, and this was one of the slides in the conference. This is a picture from the 14th century in Bologna University. It is one of the oldest universities in Europe. There are especially two things. You see the lecturer over there reading the book. So it's, although I am not standing higher than you are, the picture is more or less the same. I still have the book. You also have that student over there on the bottom left who is sleeping. This is 14th century. Well, the presenter who presented this talk was saying that, okay, you see the guy on the top right, they are talking. So in modern times, he's the one, the student who is playing with his BlackBerry in the class. Well, you see, nothing much has changed in the last, how many centuries? 6 centuries. Well, I think that's kind of interesting. I mean, I don't know how many problems we have that we knew we had 6 centuries ago, and we still couldn't solve. I mean, of course, in development, whenever there is some advance in some technology, we answer some questions, there are new questions arise, but the lifetime of most of the questions that we find are quite limited. Probably this is one of the oldest problems that we have. We know it is there. Lecturing makes students sleep. There is nothing you can do about that. There is nothing much I can do about that. You will be sleepy. But we couldn't find a way out of it yet. Why? Everybody sleeps in the class. Don't tell me that you are an exception. I mean, you can even sleep with your eyes open. Lecturer? Well, it's hard while you are walking and speaking at the same time. Well, these are the two quotes that I like. That kind of shows the way out of this problem, if we can manage to implement it. One is by Herb Simon, where apparently he was a Nobel laureate. He has the Nobel Prize on some social sciences. Well, this is the first time I heard his name. If you haven't heard of him, that's, I think, quite normal. So it says that learning results from what the student does and thinks, and only from what the student does and thinks. The teacher can advance learning only by influencing what the student does to learn. So learning is something that you do. We can help you, but we cannot force you to learn. Well, the second one, well, the reference says that he is famous. Again, it was a name that I haven't heard before. teachers do not create learning, and yet most teachers behave as if they do. Well, this is, you will see quite often that you will see around many professors saying that there are so many great, such great teachers. And learners create learning, teachers create the conditions under which learning can take place. Well, this lecturing is kind of, lecturing thing gets boring. I mean, I can see in your faces, your eyes just starts to drop down. Especially if you are sitting in the front, it's quite obvious. I mean, I'm not blaming you, don't take me wrong. I mean, it's not something that you can do. What I should do is I should give some breaks like this. That is something I should learn. I didn't used to do such thing. I'm learning. And homeworks are in fact a part of this. We should force you to do things. Well, sometimes we exaggerate how much we force you, but we should force you to do things on your own. Well, that is one of my experiences in the sense that if I tell my students that it will be good for them if they do such and such, well, 1% of the students does it or not. There's always an excuse not to do things. So the way, kind of the way to force it, oh, okay, you have to do this, not because it's good for you, but because at the end you will get this grade. This is most of the time much more motivating the students. And don't tell me that this is also wrong. Now let's continue. Walk up a bit. So the inclined plane. Now these examples. I'm sure that you can solve all these examples in just two lines. And the way I'm solving these is probably the longest possible way that you can imagine to solve these problems. But the thing is, this longest way applies in almost any problem that you can imagine. But the short way applies to particular problems only. So if you are looking for short ways, you have to memorize one short way for each problem, more or less. But if you get the meaning of the long way, yes. Oh, okay. If you get the understand how the long way works, then you can apply it to any complicated problem that you can face. So this is another problem, the inclined plane. Now this is an example where the normal force is not vertical. The normal force, remember, it is always normal to the surface. Well, that's why it's called normal. The word meaning of normal is perpendicular. So again, we are assuming there is no friction to simplify the things. So we have an inclined plane. And in this inclined plane, we have a mass. And we know what will happen. The mass will slide down and it will accelerate. And the inclination angle is just alpha. And the steps will be identical. First, draw the free body diagram. Forget anything else except than your masses. I have this mass, and I have the two forces acting on my mass. Now, I also know that my object is accelerating along the surface. I mean, it will not be jumping off the surface or just dig underground on the hill, if it's a hill. So it will be accelerating along the surface. It just tells me that the net force, this is the total force, has to be parallel to the surface. That's an information that I will be using. I just sum the weight, move the normal vector to the end of the weight. The sum, the total vector, is my total force. Well, I'm in two dimensions. It's better if I choose some coordinate axis so that I can work with the components of my vectors. I will choose a reference frame, such that the x-axis is along the incline. Why I choose it, up to you, choose whatever one you like. This will simplify my calculation because in this reference frame, the acceleration of my object, I know it has to be along the x-direction. Well, there are two unknowns here. I don't know the normal force, and hence I don't know the net force acting on my object, by the way. I don't know the acceleration of my mass. I'm trying to figure out both of them. I have two unknowns. Well, there is the normal force in this coordinate axis. I know that the normal force is in the positive y hat direction. I denote it by the its component by n. And the weight is pointing downward. Well, the y component is just, if you just consider the right triangle over there, the y component, the length of the y component is just proportional to the cosine alpha. It is the side adjacent to my angle in this right triangle. So it's mg cosine alpha along the minus y hat direction. If you look at that figure, the weight is pointing downward. It is in the minus y hat, it has a minus component along the minus y hat direction, another component along the minus x hat direction. And the component along the minus x hat direction is just mg sine alpha. Well, I have the, I don't.
But on the y direction, the net force is zero, because it's not moving.
Well, this is my net force in terms of my unknown normal force. And my unknown, well, the only unknown over there is normal force. And your friend is right. From general reasoning, I know that there is no acceleration along the y direction. So the net force along the y direction has to be zero. So this is my total force. Then I can use Newton's law. Well, that is my total force. The acceleration along the y direction has to be zero because my y direction is perpendicular to my surface and my object is always moving along the surface. So the net force along the y direction has to be zero. But if you look at my expression about the total force, the y component is n minus mg cosine alpha, which has to be zero. So the normal force was one of my unknowns. So I know that the normal force now is given by the mass times gravitational acceleration times cosine of the inclination of the hill. Well, how do I know that the angle that the omega makes with the y-axis is alpha? Well, in this case, you can again just imagine that your hill, if there it was not hill, but it was flat, this will be my y-axis. I'm tilting the y-axis by alpha degrees, so my y-axis is also tilted by alpha degrees. So the angle that my y-axis makes with the vertical is alpha degrees. W is in the vertical direction. So using the previous, well, I have the normal force, which cancels the y component of the vector. Now the total force is minus mg sine alpha. Now comes my Newton's second law. The acceleration is the net force, the total force acting on a mass, divided by its mass. And if I divide by the equation 42 by the mass, I just get that the acceleration is not g, it's not the gravitational acceleration, but g times sine alpha along the minus x hat direction. So it's a minus x direction is just down the hill. Whenever you have such a result, you should always think that whether that result makes sense or not. It's always possible to make mistakes in your calculations. You can just skip some sign over here or do some other, forget a factor two over there. And at the end, you will get a result which, if you would look at it, it wouldn't make sense. Well, this is our result. So the next thing is, does this make sense? Well, to see whether it makes sense or not, we can just check some limiting cases. Well, in this problem, there are two important limiting cases. When alpha is zero, there is no hill. So if there is no hill, the only force is the weight, but the weight is just perpendicular to the surface. So it will not be accelerating. So if alpha is zero, it should not be accelerating. And if alpha is zero, sine alpha is zero, so there is no acceleration. Well, the other limit is when the hill is vertical, alpha is 90 degrees. Well, in that case, my mass is just sliding by the wall, but it's not even touching the wall. It will not be applying any force on my hill. So the acceleration should be just g. And if you put alpha is equal to 90 degrees, the acceleration is just minus g along the x-hat direction. So at least in these two limiting cases, my result makes sense. questions? Any questions? Well, because it's in the minus x hat direction. Remember, x hat direction is going up, uphill, positive. If it's 90 degrees, x hat direction will be vertical. So minus x hat is downwards. So that is what that minus sign tells me. So the direction wise, it also makes sense. Well, here you have a graph of it. Yes. Yes, because when it's in the ground, this book is not accelerating. So it's on a flat surface. With? Yes. Just study certain special cases which you know the answer without doing any calculation. I mean, we know the answer without doing any calculation if it is not a hill but just a flat surface. We know the answer if it was not a hill but just a vertical wall. We know these two answers without doing any calculation. So we can check our result, whether our result makes sense in these two limiting cases. Our result, yeah. If you make a sign mistake somewhere in the calculation or forget some factor somewhere here or there, then most of the time, in the limiting cases, your results will not make sense. So it's a way to check your calculation.